I'm going to go through the Lao Tzu reading now, and I'm just going to cover about the first half of it or so and try to give everybody a basic understanding of some of the issues that are being brought up in the text. And a little bit to understand about it, some of the background on it is fairly important because it brings up a number of issues that we're always going to run into when we're dealing with texts really before the year in 1000 AD. Issues come up. Number one thing that comes up with the Lao Tzu reading is, who is he? We have really no idea. The textual tradition is very rough. Before we get any kind of reliable text, it's been centuries after the person has supposedly died. A number of centuries. We don't even know for sure what is his, if it's one person, what his name is. I'm using the name Lao Tzu, spelling it in that manner, because I've just gotten into the habit of it, but I've seen very good sources use this spelling of it, Lao Tzu, L-A-O-Z-I, and it's probably a better one, but you will see if you search it at all on the internet that you're going to get several different spellings of it. From what we've had handed down to us, is he does seem to have been a Chinese philosopher from around the from about 500 years, what's commonly known as BCE, before the Common Era. I do know most folks are familiar with BC, before Christ. Within anthropology and ancient history, most scholars today are using what's called BCE, Common Era, before the Common Era. So he seems to have existed around that time. If he existed, that's where the legend says he did, but the legends were written down, or the histories were written down, hundreds of years after he would have existed. But his teaching is part of what's known as the three pillars of Chinese philosophy, which include Confucianism, Buddhism, and Taoism, his being the Taoist view. Now, you will see some sources spell Taoism with a D, some spell it Taoism. Again, there's different approaches to it because of the history is all over the place. But that's the way it is. And again, this is something common to the vast majority of texts from before the year 1000, when texts were being copied by hand and handed down, and there were limited numbers of copies and limited literacy rates for them to be handed, for them to be read. So other people didn't know, and they were often corrupted and changed. And one of the primary issues to know is that when you have texts that are this old and you don't have a solid tradition, is that in all likelihood, people throughout the years added and took away things to the text and handed it down altered. If somebody were copying a text down and said, you know, my aunt Martha one time told me that she had heard that, you know, such and such was said by this writer. Well, that person could add it to the text, or there could be a local tradition or a local idea in this town that wants to add this idea to the text, and it had this this tradition, and their, you know, writers end up adding that to the text. And this type of thing almost certainly went on with Lao Tzu, and if you had something important to say, and if you can attach it to a famous name, well, what you had to say now is associated with the famous person, rather than just with yourself. So that almost certainly happened. Now, what I'll tell you, if you do end up writing on Lao Tzu, don't worry about that. Don't concern yourself with that. It's far more challenging of a task than we can get into in the course of this class to really do close textual reading. And I'm going to assume you guys don't know how to read ancient Chinese texts or go through all the textual traditions to determine which one is, you know, older or newer than the later writing. So we're going to leave that aside and just use the name Lao Tzu as its focal point for the writing, and this kind of point where it all gathers together. So there will be some contradictions because you do get different traditions being gathered under this one name. So those will happen. But again, that's part of almost everything that's written before the year 1000. So let me go into it and start going into it in a little more detail. And again, you have this picture of supposedly of Lao Tzu, but this is, again, centuries after. What you do get collected in the text, for some people this textual problem is too much, and they just say, well, we don't know what he thought, I don't want to deal with it. I would instead say what most scholars would probably think of this is the text reflects the values that were handed down through these traditions. That's what it does. It reflects the values that were handed down and what was really important to them and what they really thought, you know, made the cut as to what should be handed down. So does it have absolute integrity? Most certainly not. How much of it is really original to one person? We'll never really find out. Is it important? I think after you go through it, you'll agree that yes, it is, and it's a very powerful piece. And let me go through it. And the place to start is obviously part one, chapter one, because that's where most students throw their hands up and say, I can't make any sense out of this. And this is what it does, right from the beginning. The Tao that can be trodden is not the enduring and unchanging Tao. The name that can be, the name that can be named is not the enduring and unchanging name. Two, is conceived of as having no name, it is the originator of heaven and earth. Conceived of as having a name, it is the mother of all things. What does that mean? Well, what it brings in is an issue that comes up throughout the text, which is ambiguity. Now, ambiguity is a very important concept because it's not just being vague. It's not being vague, it is intentional. And it has an effect. It is intentionally not spelling something out, much like that line is somehow not quite clear. But ambiguity is intentionally not being direct and not being clear for a reason, because the concept, once it's clarified, it's lost. So Taoism can't really be clarified and spelled out perfectly, because once that's done, you've lost the basic concept of it, the basic idea, because there is not a concept that can be articulated clearly to describe what the Tao is. So this is setting at the heart of Taoism an idea of ambiguity, that something cannot be determined. It's going to become clear why he does that from the beginning as we go through it a little bit. But he's purposely being ambiguous with the notion of Tao. So if somebody asks, what's Taoism? You can't really respond, because once you do, you've missed it. So you can't do that. So it's an intentional start of placing ambiguity at the heart of Taoism. So that's what it's doing from the beginning. But that also, that beginning for most students, and I imagine most of you who read it threw your hands up immediately, going, this is ridiculous. It's actually supposed to be, partly supposed to be. Okay, jump down if you will. This is on page 5, a chapter 2. Paragraphs 1, 2, and 3 I'm going to go through. All in the world know the beauty of the beautiful, and in doing this they have the idea of what ugliness is. They all know the skill of the skillful, and in doing this they have the idea of what the want of skill is. So it is that existence and non-existence give birth, the one, to the idea of the other. That difficulty and ease produce the one, the idea of the other. That length and shortness fashion out of one, the figure of the other. That the idea of height and lowness arise from the contrast of the one with the other. That the musical notes and tones become harmonious through the relation of one with the other. And that being before and behind give the idea of one following another. Therefore the sage manages affairs without doing anything and conveys his instructions without the use of speech. And the term you want to know that goes on here is dichotomy. This idea of dichotomy is behind all of the ideas in Lao Tzu. And in fact, what he's going to do is claim this is really how the universe itself works, is off of these dichotomies. And when you push in one direction, what automatically happens is the universe pulls back in the opposite direction. Once you get a better understanding of what beauty is, what you're actually doing is defining what ugly is. And this is going to run throughout the text. It's going to be why we come down to that idea number 3. Therefore, the sage manages affairs without doing anything. And this is very odd, it's very hard to conceive of, because the Western notion of managing things properly means taking authority and running it and organizing it and getting things going in the right direction. what Lao Tzu is going to promote is this idea of once you start doing that, you start producing the understanding in the sense that things are also pulling back against you. Of what is disorganized and mismanaged, you create by managing things well. And so the proper leader within the Tao is the one who does not lead through his actions or her actions and make things right. Because right when you make things right, you're going to start creating things that are wrong. And that is a dichotomy. Very important concepts. The two concepts we have right from the beginning is the idea of ambiguity. And ambiguity is not being vague. Being vague means you have a lack of clarity. Ambiguity is when you are intentionally not spelling something out because it cannot be spelled out perfectly. And it is more accurately dealt with by not spelling it out, because what you're doing is actually getting it wrong by being more precise. You're missing the mark the more precise you are. Okay? So with dichotomy, the idea is that when you push it one direction, you automatically produce its opposite. Okay? And that's what Lao Tzu is going to promote throughout this writing. Jump over to the next page, page 6. This is chapter 3. I'm going to go through all the three paragraphs. Let me do the first one first to get to more of his ideology. Number 1, not to value an employment of superior ability is the way to keep people from rivalry among themselves. Not to prize articles which are difficult to procure is the way to keep them from becoming thieves. Not to show them what is likely to excite their desires is the way to keep their minds from disorder. This is an incredibly important paragraph here, or sentence or so, because it gets to this notion, which is very hard for most Westerners to actually accept, because most folks in Western societies actually prize the idea of intelligence and accomplishment. And he is pushing back directly against that. Okay. What he is promoting is that the people should be ignorant, and what you want to do is avoid a social hierarchy. Because once you start becoming knowledgeable, you actually start achieving a higher level than people out there in society and others. You start actually creating order in society, and that is a hierarchy. You get one person above another based on intellectual abilities. That's the problem, because that's right when you produce envy and desire to be like that person. And that's when you get disorder. This creates one of the most important aspects of Lao Tzu, which is desire to create within the society and with the political society as a whole, a more peaceful existence. Okay, a more peaceful existence, and the way to avoid disorder is to avoid hierarchies. Hierarchies are organizations of societies that create disorder within the individuals, because then they don't feel content with where they are. They get an emotional disorder because there is a social hierarchy. You can see probably the way that's built on this ideal of dichotomies running the universe, running the intellectual universe, but also running the universe as a whole. Whenever you push in one direction, you're going to have something pull back. So ignorance is the best way to avoid social hierarchies. If you can promote ignorance as a common way of being, that actually is the best way to avoid social hierarchies. But now, you don't promote ignorance by going out and really pushing for it, but you try to start embodying it. You don't push for education and intelligence, because once you do that, you actually create problems within the society. You actually understand who is ignorant by knowing who is intelligent. You create ignorance by promoting intelligence. That goes back to the idea of the dichotomy. And again, notice he is not trying to promote a more prosperous or a more accomplished or a wealthier country or nation or society. He is trying to promote a more peaceful society. That's his end goal. And it's always to keep that in mind. It's always important to keep that in mind when you're examining an ideology. What's the end game? Where are we going with this ideology? For Lao Tzu, it's a more peaceful society. Not a more accomplished one, but a more peaceful one is more important than one that is, say, wealthier or more advanced in our Western notion. Okay? Going on with two. Therefore the sage is the excellence in the exercise of his government, empties their minds, fills their bellies, weakens their wills, and strengthens their bones. He constantly tries to keep them without knowledge and without desire, and where there are those who have knowledge, to keep them from presuming to act on it. When there is this abstinence from action, good order is universal. And that order is a peaceful order. It does not mean one person is placed above another. It means there's order and there's not disruption. There's not violence. There's not strife. There's not disunion. Instead, everybody is content. For many Westerners, that's a very hard concept to even accept, because we often see that as being, you know, against individuals and free will. And in fact, that's exactly what it is. It is against individualism, because individualism is going to automatically create social hierarchies. That's what it's going to create. Once you assert yourself as an individual, you're going to place yourself above somebody else and automatically recognize that others are above you. That's part of individualism, and that is part of Lao Tzu's point that there are these dichotomies. Once you assert the individual, you become aware of where you are within the social hierarchy. And that's what he's trying to avoid. Okay? So I should point this out. In chapter 4, sentence 3, you're going to see a number of these, but I'm going to point this out and then move on from it. This is number 3. I do not know whose son it is. It might appear to have been before God. I really don't know what that sentence means. I'm sure I might be able to find on the internet somebody somewhere actually might be able to explain it. I don't know. But one of the most important skills you need to develop, and this might sound odd, as you work your way through college, you are going to run through or come across very difficult texts. And at times, you're not going to understand what you're reading. Try to make sense out of it. Do your best with it. But honestly, if there's something you can't make sense of, do your best and move on. I still haven't worked that out. I've been teaching this for years. I don't know what that's about. Okay? I'm okay with it. Okay, jumping over to chapter 8, number 1. This is on page 7. The highest excellence is like that of water. The excellence of water appears in its benefiting all things and in its occupying without striving to the contrary the low place which all men dislike. Hence, its way is near that of the Tao. Okay, and this is a very important thing. He's using an analogy. He's got a number of these. This isn't really a metaphor. Look at that pen, that's gone. So I guess it works very well because it doesn't work at all now. So he's using analogies which are comparisons. He's comparing one thing to another. The way to understand the Tao is not to describe it directly, but he's going to use an analogy to give you a hint of what it is, of how to understand it, which is I'm not going to define it exactly how it is. I'm going to leave it ambiguous, but I'm going to give you an understanding through an analogy. And watch his analogies. He uses a number of them throughout the text. And what he always reaches for are lifeless analogies. Water is one of the most common ones, and it's probably his best one for explaining the Tao. Water is lifeless. When he gets to the universe, the heavens, and other things, and he's not using a Christian notion of heaven. I should give a note right now. Avoid comparing this text to other religious texts or other things. Try to understand it in its own right and on its own terms. He mentions heaven. For many Westerners, heaven is a Christian notion of heaven, where we go in the afterlife. He's not using it in that sense. Okay, so he's using it in the sense of the skies and, you know, above. So he's always using that in a lifeless sense, and that becomes his model for the Tao. But he always tells you it's not perfect as an analogy, but it's close. And that's as good as I'm going to do. But notice that water, by its very nature, aids others, not by trying to, but just by accepting things the way they are. And by always taking a lower position whenever it can. And under almost all circumstances, it always goes to the lowest place it can go to. And in that way, it serves all people. That becomes his analogy of the Tao. Okay? Very important. His analogies are probably the best way to define those opening sentences that were so tough to understand. Jumping down to chapter 13 on page 7, favor and disgrace would seem equally to be feared, honor and great calamity to be regarded as personal conditions of the same kind. What is meant by speaking thus of favor and disgrace? Disgrace is being in a low position after enjoyment of favor. The getting that favor leads to the appreciation of losing it, and of losing it leads to the fear of still greater calamity. That is what is meant by saying that favor and disgrace would seem equally to be feared. Gets back to the dichotomy idea that political actions or political ideas always produce their opposites. So right when you try to get honor, what you are now at risk of is disgrace. So right when you try to get a position of high authority, you are in a position to be taken down very far. Those ideas are always inexplicably linked. Bad pronunciation there. But always political actions produce a less peaceful society. They produce an agitation also, an emotional agitation. You become aware of failure far more acutely once you've achieved success. That's what he's pointing out. So don't focus on success, because now you're always at risk and in fear of failure. If you accept the way water accepts its position to always just accept things the way they are shaped, then you don't live with the fear. Okay. And let me point out last couple things on chapter 15. This is on page 8. This is paragraphs 3 and 4. These are usually quite clear to folks, but they're very important too. Who can make the muddy water clear? Let it be still and it will gradually become clear. Who can secure the condition of rest? Let movement go on and the condition of rest will gradually arise. They who persevere this method of the Tao do not wish to be full of themselves. It is through their not being full of themselves that they can afford to seem worn and not appear anew and complete. So always political actions produce a less peaceful society. Once you try pushing in one direction as a political leader, you're always going to produce your opposite. Certainly American history is filled with examples of that, which I won't get into. But how do you create a less muddy water? Leave it alone. Leave it alone and make sure it is left alone if you want to make things clear. That is probably one of his most important analogies throughout the whole text for a political leader. If you want clear water, stop trying to fix it and make sure others do not fix it too. That's going to make things better. Okay? He has in chapter 17 these wonderful ages where he says societies were best when they weren't even aware of their leaders. They didn't see them as dignified, they didn't see them as great, they weren't even aware of them. They ran the society themselves, as far as they were concerned. And in that sense, most people see Lao Tzu as being inherently a liberal. Now, there are elements to him that could be defined as being more conservative. But he's seen as being a liberal because he's promoting this more decentralized approach to governance. In other words, the leader does not take charge of things. He lets the people be and wants them to be on their own. He also goes against hierarchies. Hierarchies produce institutions that run the society as a whole. That's what it does. Okay? Hierarchies always stratify society, and they have at the top either an individual or an institution that's seen as more powerful than the others. So he's against the hierarchies. Okay? This is why he's a liberal. And the final element that's very important to understand is that his end game is always a more peaceful society. That's where he wants to go. That's not something that's necessarily seen as either liberal or conservative. He is liberal because he sees no need for a centralized government, and he sees people, if they're not corrupted by culture, as being inherently capable of achieving that peaceful society, if they are left to themselves and not modified. That's how he's seen as being a liberal. But his end goal, that more peaceful society, can be seen in either liberal or conservative ideologies. Okay? The rest of the text goes into several other different issues, but if you have this much down, you should be able to make sense of it. You can probably see why, I'm not going to go to it right now, but there's problems with wisdom. Because once you're wise, you become aware of ignorance. So that's going to go come up later on, and several other issues in the second half of it, where he goes into more detail with things. Okay? Take care.